morning singing a song, singing a praise to God. Miss Dee, go ahead and click on that video. And let's stand to our feet if you're able, and let's sing together.
Make my choices and determine,
you know, determine what leaders we'll vote for, what we'll do, whether we can do a good job, a bad job, all those things. Those things are there, and I understand that. And I ask that you continue to pray for that. But this morning, we have many brothers and sisters that have gone to be with Christ in this past week. The church in Afghanistan, the one there in Kabul has been martyred. They're gone. They're gone. They're worshiping together. Taliban comes in, just kills them all. As they continue to sing. You know, many of us in the United States would think to ourselves, they saw the Taliban coming in, they knew what was going on, they should have, which they were already underground, you understand that, but you also understand that there's a certain level when you are in these countries and you are part of the underground church, there is some secrecy to where you're meeting and what you're doing, but at the same time, you have to let people know that you are there, because otherwise, how can you spread the gospel? You can't hide all the time. And this particular group chose, even though the Taliban came in and took the city, they chose to meet together. They chose to stand and worship and praise and sing to God, even as they knew it might be their death, and it did. So this morning, I'm going to ask, here's the thing. In every way, I've always said to you that you can pray anywhere you are, and God hears you. And that is true today. Okay? But I'm going to, as your pastor, I'm going to ask that some of you that feel able and willing, that you come forward and that we take an opportunity for special prayer for our church around the world, especially those that are in Afghanistan that are facing imminent danger, though there are others that are facing imminent danger every day in many countries. China is cracking down. There are others in the Middle East. There are other churches in Russia and many other places that things are getting worse for them. And if it doesn't just mean economic problems, if it doesn't just mean not being able to get a job or being persecuted in some way, in many places it's also now meaning their death or even the death of their family, their whole families, or the whole church. So this morning I'm going to ask that we take a moment. If you're able, come forward with me. Let's just kneel right up. I'm going to kneel right over here so we can be with them. And let's just take a few moments of silence. And I'm going to ask you to pray for the church around the world, especially those that are being persecuted so hard, especially that church in Afghanistan. So just give us a few moments, and then I will end us in prayer. So if you will, come forward if you're able. And let's pray. Like to, you're welcome to sit on some of these front rows here. It's harder to kneel. Let's just take some time of silence, and if you would pray for the persecuted church. God, this morning, Lord, our hearts go out to our brothers and our sisters around the world. Dear God, we've heard stories like this before. But it's not really new to us, dear God. Or to hear the church standing, proclaiming and singing your praises, dear God, and then to be gunned down for no other reason than just, Lord, believing in you, praising you, and telling others of your love. Lord God, first I ask, dear God, because, Lord, my heart goes out for my brothers and sisters, Lord. And Lord, my desire is that you protect them, dear God, that you, Lord, supernaturally protect them, that you keep them from harm, dear God, that you keep them from these, Lord, who would kill them and, Lord, would rape them. And dear God, just utterly do their best to destroy them in this world, dear God. Lord, I ask, dear God, that you protect them. But Lord God, more so, because I know, dear God, your will. More so, dear God, I ask for your boldness and your strength to be upon them. Lord, as this one proclaimed on the phone, dear God, Lord, that they all felt your boldness, dear God, to stand in the midst of what was going on. Lord, God, we've seen pictures, dear God, of men running and doing crazy things, jumping on planes, and all kinds, just to try to escape, to try to get away. But dear God, this church, they came together. Lord, they stood and they began to sing praises to you in the midst of all this, dear God. Not running for their lives, dear God, but proclaiming your glory and proclaiming your praise, dear God, because you are first in their lives, Lord, not their own lives. So, dear God, I ask that you continue to give them boldness and to give them strength to stand, to proclaim your word to any who will listen, dear God. And, Lord God, as that voice goes out, dear God, even when that voice goes out and it is silenced, dear God, that your power, Lord, takes that to the ears and to the hearts of others. Dear God, as the prayer of this list, dear God, said, Lord, I ask that, Lord, those that are in there that have murdered them, that have killed them, Lord, I ask that they see the thing, that they see, dear God, your power and the boldness that you have given, that they hear your message, dear God, and that they repent, Lord, that they become that voice, dear God, that will stand and proclaim even unto death, dear God, that you are the Lord, that you are the way of salvation. And dear God, Lord, please pour your Spirit out upon us and heal us, Lord. That your church might awaken, dear God. That we will not just stand, dear God, politically and in other ways, dear God, but Lord, that we will go out in the power that you give us, dear God, to proclaim the gospel, to change one heart at a time, one family at a time. Lord, to you be the glory. Lord, I thank you for what I read in Scripture, dear God, the reward that awaits these, Lord, as they enter your kingdom. But Lord, comfort those that mourn, you're still here. Lord, we ask all of this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God is good, church, and God has blessed us in the United States that we don't suffer these same things. But let that not make us sleep. God, let that not make us become too casual or fake. But may we be just as bold to go out and proclaim the gospel. All right, Miss Dean. Idea of what's next? Yeah. All right. What is that, kids? Oh, there we are. Where's my little girl? There she is. Come on, big girl. You're going to have a heart attack. You're so excited. Very excited. Takes after his day. Good morning. It's good to see you. Miss Darden, I'm going to pick on you to be the light person today. But guess what? I want you to watch something real quick, okay? I want you to watch a little video, and then we're going to talk about something. Miss D, go right ahead.
Jam.
Hey, Zoe, catch!
I'm open!
Maybe we should tell Dad.
What if he gets mad?
He might take away all our toys.
He might send us away forever.
He might sell the Xbox!
Oh no!
Ah!
Money! Money! Money!
Let's tell Dad there was an earthquake.
That's a good idea.
A robber knocked it over.
Let's tell Dad that Ashlyn did it.
No!
But it's your fault. You threw the ball. If you caught the ball, this never would have happened.
Your fault!
Your fault.
It's your fault!
It's your fault!
It's your fault!
Your fault! Your fault! It's your fault! It's your fault! Your fault!
Hey guys, what's going on? What are you fighting about?
Well, it's
I threw a ball and broke the glass.
And I didn't catch the ball.
Yeah, they broke it.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
It was an accident.
Well, it sounds like you guys learned your lesson. How about we clean this mess up now?
I'll get the broom.
Clean up, clean up, clean up. Everybody clean up.
If you break something sharp, like glass, have a parent help you clean it up.
It's dangerous.
And remember, be honest and tell the truth.
And clean up your messes.
All right. All right, Miss Darla. Let me ask you something. They spilled the milk and they broke the glass, right? Did their dad get mad and take all their toys away? Did he kick them out of the house? Did he sell their Xbox? What did he do?
Nothing.
Nothing. You know, sometimes when we do stuff and we're scared we're going to get in trouble, so sometimes we want to start blaming other people, and sometimes we even want to tell a lie, tell our mamas and daddies that, no, I didn't do that, or somebody else did it. But do you think God wants us to tell lies? No. Look at this Bible verse. It says, all you need to say is simply yes or no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. That means to tell the truth. It means just, when you say yes, it means yes, and that's the truth. And when you say no, it means no, and that's the truth. Everybody stand up and look at your point of your parents in here. Look at Miss Mary Lee over there. Oh. Ooh, Jesse back there. Oh, Miss D, she looks mean. I don't know. Do you think if you do something wrong and you tell the truth, you think these people are going to kick you out of the house? Or they're going to hate you forever? No. Chances are, listen, do you think you might get in trouble a little bit if you did something that was kind of dumb? Yeah, you might get in trouble. But do you think your parents will keep loving you? Do you think your parents will love you even when you do bad things? Yes. So make sure when you do things that you tell the truth, that you tell Mama and Daddy and tell them the truth, okay? Because lying is not what God wants us to do. And what happens, Lindy Rose, if something happens and one in our family tells a lie and then I find out the truth, isn't it much worse if I have to find out they told me a lie? Because the punishment for lies is a lot worse than whatever the first thing you did most of the time, okay? So never tell a lie. Always tell Mom and Dad the truth, okay? All right, let's go to the Lord and let's pray. And then you can grab a piece of candy if you'd like. And let's see, who's back there? Where's Carly? Carly back there? Nope, she must be in the... Okay, well, Joshua's back there. Joshua, direct them to get one of their tablets there. I mean, one of their folders and then one of their crayons, okay? All right, let's pray, okay? God, we thank you for today. We thank you, Lord, that we can tell the truth. And Lord, there are some kids that have parents that are not very nice. But Lord, you have blessed all of us with parents who really do love us. Lord, help us always to be truthful with them. And help our parents always to love us, no matter what we do. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, grab me a fruit gummy or a candy. And then go back there and Joshua will help you, or Josh will help you with your color pages, okay? Get a color page and you pray on this. All right, Miss D. Let's go ahead and jump to the next, which I believe is a song, isn't it? All right, let's do it. All right, let's sing together. If you're able, stay with me. And let's sing together. I believe this is one of my favorites. Amazing Grace. Go ahead, Miss D. I think you have to click it one time. I might have to click it one more time. There we go.
Yeah. Pastor, I wanted to mention that right after church, just need a 5-minute meeting with the church council members, whoever can stay, just to visit about a little thing.
All right. So those of you that I've talked to about the various positions and things, you got voted in last week. So those of you that I know I've mentioned about being a church council and all, you could stay for just a few minutes right after service. All right. All right. Well, this morning, we're going and continuing on with our Sermon on the Mount. I tell you, this has been somewhat of a tough thing at times. Some of the topics have been kind of tough, but that's kind of the thing is, you know, Jesus desires for us to get out of a comfortable place. He wants us not to just assume what He says or assume how we're to live, but He actually wants us to study and know, because a lot of times we find ourselves living legalistic lifestyles. We find ourselves living lifestyles devoid of grace many times. But He wants us to know there's more to life than what we just assume. And in fact, that's what this Sermon on the Mount is about. Jesus is beginning to go out. He's going to be going out and stronger. He's got His disciples. He's been baptized, all the things that He was wanting to accomplish initially. He has been tempted and tested and is now going forth to proclaim His message. And this Sermon on the Mount is bringing out what He is saying to the world. Steve, click that first one there. So what has He said? He said in verse 1 through 12 in the Beatitudes, what he asks us to be is different many times than what we think. Just what I just said. He tells us what we are to be, and it's very different than what the Jews thought that we were to be, and it's very different even than many of us think that we should be. Then we go to verses 13 through 16. And we are different so the world can distinguish us from them. Believers are to be salt and light. He says, I expect you to be something very different than what you think. And the reason I expect you to be that way is because everybody out there in the world thinks the same way. They think these things too. Out there, they may not live by it, but they have an idea of what is right and wrong. They have an idea of how a Christian is supposed to live, even if they are not one. But you are to be something different, so that when you are out there, they see something different and they want to know, what is that? What is that? Christ Himself in verse 17 through 20, He says, now I did not come to do away with the law. I still am going to do the things that are good and not do the things that are bad. Okay? I'm still going to live that way. He even continued in the sculpture of the way that His society and the Jewish faith had scripted with the feasts and the other ceremonies and all this. He continued to do that because it was right to do those things. It was the way the people had determined in their religion to accomplish the things that God has called them to do. So He did that as an example to us, not to do away with that stuff, but He came to fulfill that, to show us how then those things, what is the point of all this? To show us how to live, and He did that. He came to fulfill that law. And then there at the bottom, He said, for I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. And it is from here that He begins to describe how in the world we can be more righteous than the Pharisees, who were the pinnacle of the law keepers. They kept the law. They did what was supposed to be. And we've seen some of the examples, and we're continuing in the examples. He's giving us examples on what it means to be this different person. He began by giving us an example of sin in the heart. You remember the Old Testament scriptures, the law says not to murder, but He says, I tell you what, if you hate somebody in your heart, you've murdered them already in your heart. Sin is not just an action. Sin is also of the heart. It's your intention. It's what's inside of you that needs to change and be different. Then He goes on, He gives another example of adultery. Many of you may not have looked at that, you know, hunk of a man flexing his muscles on the TV, and went out and had a physical affair. But what went on? on in your mind, ladies? What went on in your mind then when you were on the internet or at the beach or something? There are times that we do things, and inside, though we do not physically cheat on our spouse, there are times that in our minds, in our hearts, we lust, which brings on sin. Then last week, I tell you, it was a very, very hard sermon for me, because I know it touches people's hearts, but it celebrated what marriage is. It's oneness in the eyes of God. And then spoke of divorce, which is violence. It destroys. God is asking us to be something different than what we think, especially what society says we should be. So one more example, Miss D. Another example here in this particular passage found in 33 through 37. Matthew chapter 5, 33 through 37. Let's read the whole thing and then let's go through it a little bit. It says, "Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform your oath to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king, nor shall you swear by your head, because you cannot make one hair white or black. But let your yes be yes, and your no be no, for whatever is more than these is from the evil one." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, I ask that you open up your word to us today. And dear God, you bring integrity into our lives. That our yes be yes, our no be no. That you be glorified in how we live, in the things that we say, and the things that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, Ms. D, click that next section. All right, let's take this and break it up in just three sections that we can kind of see what he's saying. All of us have a good idea of what he's saying. The overall idea here is, let's be honest, right? But let's look into it a little bit deeper and see if we can find some things that maybe we didn't think right off the bat. Verse 33. "Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform your oaths to the Lord." All right, Ms. D, click that next one. Simple point. If you take an oath, keep it. You take an oath, keep it. Let me read these Old Testament scriptures, just a couple of them. There's more, but these are just a couple of them that I came across in looking at these. "If a man makes a vow to the Lord or swears an oath to bind himself to by some agreement, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceeds out of his mouth." If you make today we'd say a promise, right? If you make a promise, if you make an oath, if you take a vow of some sort, keep it. Ecclesiastes 5:4. "When you make a vow to God, do not delay to pay it, for he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you have vowed." What are some of the examples of vows we take today? We can look at big ones. We spoke of the vow of marriage last week, didn't we? That's a big one. Do we not stand before God and proclaim that we are one till death do us part? If you have it, keep it. Do whatever. Fight. Do whatever you have to do to keep that vow. If you weren't here last week and this is something on your mind, please go back. It's on our Facebook page. It's on my YouTube channel, Mike Clem's channel. Go back and listen to that sermon. Because Christ, when he said cling to that wife, he meant it. With all that you are, with all that you have. Okay? So what are some of the promises and vows? I wonder about things that we do to our kids. Now, this is one thing that I've made particular point not to do, because my kids are bad about, they come up and say, "Dad, Dad, let's play Fortnite." And I said, "Buddy, I got things to do." "Well, you promised that you would do this." "No, I didn't." "How do I know no, I didn't?" "Because I've been making a point not to do that. I'm not going to make a vow that I might not be able to keep. Now, I might say, I'm hoping tomorrow we can do this. Maybe tomorrow, maybe this day we can plan it, maybe we can do this." But parents, you know, we make a lot of promises to our kids that goes in one ear and out the other, because they know. They might not. And you said, "But that's just life. Children understand that. I had full intention of doing it, but I didn't." But you promised them. You promised them. Your word, You gave them your word. Even if you didn't say, I promise, you said to them, we will do this tomorrow. My friends, that's why many of our children grow up not thinking we're much of our word. I think there were some movies like that, about parents. I'm trying to think of one, some Christmas movie with Arnold Schwarzenegger. Y'all remember that one? And he just always promised the boy he'd get stuff. So finally, it was the last straw. He knew the boy didn't trust him, didn't listen to the word. So he had to get that Christmas toy. Y'all remember that one? That was crazy. But we need to be careful about making promises or just speaking just our word to people. We're going to find out why in a minute. Remember, Jesus did not come to do away with the law. So it's still here. If we make a vow, and there are vows that we make, if we make a vow, keep it. Keep that. It's important. He didn't come to do away with those things, do away with the law, but to fulfill it, and I think maybe even to expand upon it. Let's see about that in the next slide, see? All right, let's look at this next section. But I say to you, says Jesus, do not swear at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Nor shall you swear by your head, because you cannot make one hair white or black. Let's de-click on that next one. Let's just make a simple point here. Don't vow by anything bigger than you, or even by your own merit. Don't vow that way. You are not omniscient, you are not omnipresent, or timeless. You cannot say for sure what will be. Jesus says that they will come when the clouds roll back, and he will step forth, and he will call to those that are his, and they will come to him. Is that going to come to be? Is there any question about that? Why? Because he has always kept his promises. And guess what? There's not going to be some great galactic emergency over here in these galaxies that he has to deal with last minute so he can't come do it, is there? Because he knows what's going to be. He has always been. He will forever be. He knows all things. He is omniscient. He knows what will be as well as what has been. He is omnipresent. He can be in all places. He can take care of that galactic explosion, you know, bazillions of light years away over here, and still be there with you as you're on your knees crying out to him. But can you do these things? Can you say to your child, can you say to your mom and daddy, can you say to your neighbor, can you say to someone else, hey, tomorrow at this time, I will absolutely, without a doubt, I promise you, without a doubt, I will be there. Can you say that and be 100% sure? No. And we need to start thinking that way because people are beginning to look at us and question our character. Some of you are tradesmen. I have done some things in the past. When I told my employer I would be there, if I didn't show up, or if I showed up and I was an hour late, I could have all the excuses and reasons in the world, but what did that do for the employer? Made him think a certain thing. What about a second time? It happened again. What about a third time? It happened again. What does the employer begin to think? What does that do to who we are? We need to fulfill our commitments. But understand, when we make promises, when we give our word, and it does not happen, our character begins to be destroyed. We cannot know for sure of all things. We are not omniscient, not omnipresent, not timeless like our Lord is. So be careful on what you promise. I love that little thing. What is it? Don't rain, the creek don't rise, right? Unless I'm providentially hindered, you hear a lot of Christian people saying that. Why? On purpose, because they've gone through this particular sermon before. And they'll say, Tessa, tomorrow night, 6 o'clock, right? 6 o'clock tomorrow night, Tessa, I'm going to be there if any way possible. I'm going to be there. If I'm not there, you know something major happened, but I'm going to do everything I can to be there, right? And that's true, okay? If something happens, all right. We'll find out. We'll pray for you. But that's why people say that. The more things you say and don't fulfill, the more eroded your character becomes to people. And you begin to lose that salt and lose that light to others. Deuteronomy 23:21-22, when you make a vow to the Lord your God, you shall not delay to pay it, for the Lord your God will surely require it of you, and it would be sin to you. But if you abstain from vowing, it shall not be sin to you. If I say, Tessa, I promise you, I will be there tomorrow night. Well, I get sick, something happens, can't give her a phone call for whatever reason. I done promised her. Y'all, is that a sin? Yeah, it is. Is that a lie? That's a lie. I understand I was hindered by something else, but it's still a lie. I need to say here, Tessa, if any way possible, I won't be there until 2:00 tomorrow night if I can. Any way possible, okay? And you say, that's just words. No, it's not. It's character. Okay? If I'm not there, Tessa, you know something's wrong. And I'll do my best to give you the end of that. Okay? So make sure not to allow your character to be eroded. All right, our last section, Miss D. Verse 37. When we had for the kids this morning. But let your yes be yes, and your no, no. For whatever is more than these is from the evil one. Look at James 5:12 there. It also says a very similar thing. It says, but above all, my brethren, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or with any other oath, but let your yes be yes, and your no, no. Lest you fall into judgment. Or that word judgment there actually is also translated hypocrisy, fall into hypocrisy. That's a little bit of a tough one there, isn't it? Let your yes be yes, and your no be no. This one's a really, really important one to me, okay? Because here's what I feel about it. I think as our society has moved along, I think in recent years we hear more people, if Dan comes to me and says, I need something, and we got more people going, I promise you, I'm going to be there, I'm going to be on time. And they feel like they have to, to let him know they're going to be there. I think in the old days, I remember in the old days when if somebody needed something and they told Grandpa, my Grandpa was, I've told you before, he was kind of an interesting character. But Grandpa would say, all right, and he'd walk away. But let me tell you something. Today in church, we got several church leaders in here, and here's what we do because we have to, it's sad, we have to. We say, hey, this is going on, here's this, that, and the other. But people let it fly away and go away, so we feel like we have to go back and tell them again. We have to go back and make sure, hey, I just want to remind you, we got something tomorrow. Okay. And we feel like we have to do that because too many times stuff in the church just gets put away. But when my granddaddy said, all right, he walked away, no man ever worried about it. The day that it needed done or whatever else, there was no doubt in the world when that man showed up there, Grandpa would be right there. There was no need for anything else. Today it's different. I think it's life. I think it's the busyness of life. We want to help people. We want to be a part of something. We want to do something. So we say, yeah, I want to do that. I'll be there, no doubt. I will be there. Yes, definitely. But something happens because life goes on, right? There's work, there's families, there's the craziness and the busyness of life in general. Things happen to the car, people get sick, all kinds of other things happen in the world. So we end up not showing up and go, oh man, I'm so sorry, I meant to be there, I'm so sorry about that. And that happens a lot because of the busyness of this world. But we as Christians, should we not be those that say yes? And the person, walk off and never think of it again and know who's taking care of us. Shouldn't that be how they see us? This is what Jesus is saying. Because the character of these people be more righteous than the scribes and Pharisees. Then when you say yes, it's yes. When you say no, it's no. That's character, is it not? Y'all remember being taught as children what character means, right? It's who you are when nobody's looking, right? When you've given that promise and your desire really is there to help somebody, and then life moves on, does that take an important role, or do you let it slide away? This is what Jesus is saying. As those of us that are His followers, we've got to be better. You might say, it's, oh, I promise somebody or something. It's just pity, it's just words, it's systematics. No, Jesus is trying to get you to understand it's not. It's character. It's who you are. And who you are is a representation or a reflection of God. Remember, you were made in the likeness. You are the image of Christ. You are the body of Christ. You are the representatives of God on this earth. Let your yes be yes. Let your no be no. That be it. Let's go to the prayer. Lord God, this morning, you are good. This morning, dear God, we praise you because, Lord, when you speak to us, Lord, when you are in your word and you say, this will be, or that will be, Lord God, it is. Lord God, help us to be so. Lord, we know that in life there are things that will, that can hinder, that can stop when we have full desire to do something, Lord. But, dear God, if those things happen, Lord, help us to, Lord, to do all that we can, to fall all over ourselves, dear God, to get back, to make right, to do good, Lord, and make it right. But, Lord, help your church, the church of character. Lord, help the world. Lord, they can hold all kinds of things against us and think all kinds of bad things about what we believe and the things that we do. But dear God, if nothing else, dear God, help the world to see, if nothing else, we are honest. Lord, I ask you to bless each one of this church body. Lord, that you will make us the church to this area. That you will build our character, our reputation, that we might spread the gospel. With clarity, dear God. And that those will hear because they know who we are. Lord, to you be all the honor, all the glory, and all things. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, if you're able to, stand with me. Let's sing our closing hymn, Family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by